thus under these circumstances, justifying him in slaughtering some of these tribes, enslaving and raping their women and children, humiliating and onerously taxing them, and finally expelling them from the Arabian Peninsula. Listeners, please be aware that these Arabian tribes, who had converted willingly and without coercion to the religions of the Jews and Christians, were forced out of the land of their nativity 1400 years ago unto this day. These tribes had even more right to be in the peninsula of the Arabs than he and his murderous followers, since they were productive and cultured people, while Muhammad and his thugs were destructive. Throughout the Muhammadan Muslim conquests, his followers had to emulate his sunnah by continuing the plunder, pillaging, rape, sequestering and taxing the conquered peoples to conversion, subjugation or death. The Arab conquerors took over the magnificent cathedrals and churches of the Christians and converted them into mosques. Saint John the Baptist in Damascus was among the first to be converted. The process of turning churches into mosques was especially intensive in the villages, with the gradual conversion of the conquered people to Muhammadan Islam because of the onerous jizya tax. After the Arabs' conquest of Persia, Zoroastrian fire temples with their four axial arch openings were usually turned into mosques simply by setting a mihrab, prayer niche, on the place of the arch nearest to Qibla, the direction of Mecca. This practice is described by numerous Muhammadan sources. Zoroastrian temples converted into mosques in such a manner can be found in Bukhara, modern Uzbekistan, as well as in other Iranian cities. During his persecution of the Christian Copts of Egypt, who were and are actually the indigenous, original and native Egyptians, the Abbasid Caliph Al-Ma'mun turned many churches into mosques, both in Cairo and in Egyptian villages, which had no mosques in the earlier generations of Muhammadan Islam. The Fatimid Khalif Al-Hakim also converted numerous churches and synagogues into mosques. Hagia Sophia, the most magnificent Eastern Orthodox Church, was converted into a mosque on the day of the fall of Constantinople. The destruction of Hindu temples in India during the Muhammadan Islamic invasions had occurred from the beginning of their conquests until the end of the Mughal Empire throughout the Indian subcontinent. This disgusting roadmap of such piracy and plunder boggles the mind. What is most sickening of all is the fact that the followers of Muhammad have never repented at all, but are obscene in regaling and boasting of these issues even as I'm reciting this to you today. The same global plunderers who whine and complain about Western imperialism and how the Christians should repent to the Muhammadans gloat incessantly of their conquests and subjugation of hundreds of millions of people without regret or remorse. It was Muhammad, after all, who was the first to unilaterally declare total and eternal jihadi war against humanity 1400 years ago. But his followers have the affront and obscene hypocrisy of reminding the world only about the crusades that came about as a result of Muhammadan persecution and plunder of Christian pilgrims to the Holy Land. In the 20th century, the number of projective identifications perpetrated by Muhammad's followers multiplied 100-fold. The Arabs were liberated by the Western Allies after World War I from the 500 years yoke of the Ottoman Empire, but no gratitude whatever is either mentioned or shown by any of them to this fact. All they do is complain about the alleged Western imperialism that lasted no more than a century, while Arab and Muhammadan imperialism continues unabated to this day upon millions of square miles and hundreds of millions of people for the last 1400 years. While the world refugee problem prior to and just after 1948 involved no less than 40 million people, all we hear about in and from the United Nations are the alleged 700,000 Arab refugees who were actually the result of the Arab aggression against the creation of the State of Israel as mandated by the United Nations in 1947. Without that war of aggression, there would have been no Arab or Jewish refugee problems. We hear and read nothing about the millions of Hindu refugees from what became known as the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. Nor do we hear about the millions of German, Cossack, and Eastern European refugees. Also, most deliberately absent are the facts about the Jewish refugees from Arab and Islamic lands, numbering no less than 900,000 souls who were forced out of their ancestral lands after the creation of Israel and who had nothing whatsoever to do with the conflict. The reason for these omissions are, as usual, obvious. The Mohammedan Muslim states comprise almost 28% of the membership of the United Nations, with their enormous financial and political clout to add insult to injury. That is why we have on the human rights chair of the United Nations creatures from Syria, Libya, or other Mohammedan states who, as we all very well know, practice the cleanest and best human rights in the world. It is the followers of Muhammad who accuse the Jews of 14 millions of trying to dominate the world, while they, of 1400 millions, never stop from declaring their crystal clear intention to achieve this very goal in every mosque sermon, in their TV, their print, their schools, and their radio. It is they who accuse the Jews of the blood libel, when it is alleged that the Jews use human Christian blood in their unleavened bread during their Passover, a libel that Christians know is a lie, while we watch with horror and disgust how the fundamentalist followers of Muhammad actually cut the throat of their chained victims on television in front of hundreds of millions of people in the name of Allah and Islam. It is they who strut on their military and other parades with the goose step and the Hitler salute, but accuse the Americans and the Israelis of being Nazis. It is they who incite in their mosques, their educational books, and in their media the most obscene levels of hatred, racism, warmongering, and mendacities against 80% of humanity, the so-called unbelievers, but accuse all others of discriminating against the followers of Muhammad. It is they who complain that they are persecuted when we see almost daily the resultant carnage, death and destruction perpetrated by the followers of Muhammad in 95% of all global acts of terror in the name of Allah and Islam against unarmed and innocent civilians from the Philippines and Indonesia to Kashmir, from India and Saudi Arabia to Chechnya, from South Africa to South America, from Europe to the United States, and from Israel to Mauritania. We invariably use Israel as an example because although it is physically one of the smallest countries in the world, of about 8,000 square miles and only 6.5 million people, it ranks second only after the United States of America of over 300 million as the most discussed country in the world's news media, thanks to the Arabs and the followers of Muhammad. They are, after all, faithfully following in the footsteps of their mentor Muhammad, of victimizing the Judaized and Christian Arabs, but now they are targeting the Jews and Christians, as well as others, of course, in the 21st century. As the French saying goes, plus ça change, plus ça change pas. That is, the more we perceive change, the less there is any. And last but not least is the recent case of Hamas in Gaza, who is accusing Israel of breaking the ceasefire under the pretext that they, Hamas, are shooting rockets at its civilians, and hence, in the perverted mind of projective identification, it is Israel that is violating the ceasefire agreement. In Arabic, there is a proverb, قَتَلَنِي وَبَكَى سَبَقَنِي وَاشْتَكَى, which means, he assaulted me and cried, then he preceded me to complain. Muhammad's virus is incubated into the mind of every so-called believer, rendering them into clones of extremely dangerous and volatile, unthinking, and her mentality automatons.